So, good morning, everybody. Welcome to church today. We do have one or two guests with us. We've got some folk all the way from Banbridge, all the way from London and California. And Gary, lovely to see you. And online as well from, well, potentially all over the world. So everyone is welcome at worship today. A couple of announcements to make just before we begin. First of all, we're having a midweek this Wednesday. We're going to have maybe six of these or so in the next couple of months. And we're going to meet in the McFerrin Hall, 7:30 Wednesday night. If you'd like to come, bring your Bible. We'll have a little bit of Bible study together. We're going to remind ourselves of some Christian basics. Really, what are some of the essential beliefs and values and practices of Christianity? So if you're a young Christian or if you've been a Christian for 50 years, doesn't matter. If you'd like to come for a little refresher course, you're welcome Wednesday night. Over the 6 weeks, we're going to be looking specifically at communion and what it means to be a full communicant member of the Presbyterian Church in Ireland. Now, you may be a follower of Christ or not yet, but interested. You may be interested in coming to communion, but you'd like to know more about it first. No problem. Come along these Wednesday nights. Find out a little bit more. No pressure. And at the end of that time, if you think you would like to become a communicant member of the congregation, then we can chat individually about that. Again, no pressure, and see how you feel. Okay? So that's starting this Wednesday, 7:30, McFerrin Hall. Then the Presbyterian Women, the annual conference was yesterday. It's online. If you missed it, if you'd like to see it, then it's on the Presbyterian website. And the link to that is on Cairncastle's Facebook page and also on our website. Right, I think that's all for now. We are going to worship God, and I would invite you to stand up with me, and we are going to read a few verses of scripture together from Psalm number 40. Verses 1 to 3. So would you like to stand to your feet, please? And we will, first of all, read these verses together. We declare them aloud. This is really a testimony of someone who realized their need. They were in a slimy pit, in a bad situation. But they turned to God, and they prayed, and they waited upon him. And their testimony is that they got the help that they needed. So let's read these verses aloud. And we'll read, I think it's three verses, we read all three verses together. The testimony of someone who's trusted in God and found the help they need. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Stay standing, please. We're going to sing words of another psalm. It's as the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you.
You are Lord,
let me lead you first of all, and then in a moment we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. Almighty God, maker and ruler of everything, our Father in heaven, what a lovely privilege. What an honor to be allowed to come into your holy presence through the name of Jesus, your Son. Thank you that we may cry out, Abba, Father, Daddy. Because whatever age we are, whatever circumstances we are in, we need your help. We need your kindness, your generosity, and in certain places, your mercy. We need forgiveness for the silly, stupid things, disobedient, really quite twisted things we've done. Oh Lord, we need to be better people than we are. And we can't manage that on our own. We've tried. We're so glad we can come to you and find that you've already come a distance to meet us. That you're running, hurrying down the laneway to welcome us home. We don't deserve that, but we're so glad. So we admit before you what we are. We're your creation. We're beloved by you, but we are messed up in different ways. Thank you for the welcome. We pray now that you would give us wise and obedient minds and hearts that are open to be welcomed and embraced and led by you in paths of righteousness and obedience. Help us, dear Lord, to live and walk in a manner worthy of your grace and your love. May we walk in the footsteps of your Son, our Saviour, our Master, our friend, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. He taught us to pray like this. We say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's listen to some more of God's word now. Reading from the Gospel according to Luke chapter 4, reading from verse 1. Iris is going to come and read that for us now.
The temptation of Jesus. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from Jordan and led by the Spirit in the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. Jesus answered, It is written, Man does not live on bread alone. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. So if you worship me, it will be yours. Jesus answered, It is written, Worship the Lord your God and serve him only. The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command the angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered, it says, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Iris. Now, I wonder, does anybody here have any sportswear by the company Nike? Nike? Well, even you don't, maybe you've seen some of the advertising, and you might have seen that they have a little motto or a little kind of an advertising line, and it's just three words, which begin with J-D-I. I wonder if anyone knows what that would be. Have you seen that anywhere? Could anybody have a wild guess at what it might be? If you see Nike, usually these three words are somewhere not far away, maybe on the poster or even on the piece of clothing. Anyone know what it might be? Nike?
Just do it.
Just do it. That's the motto. Just do it. I'm trying to think, what does that mean? Maybe if you're training for sport, for an event, and of course you want to win, and you're thinking, oh, I'm not sure, I'm feeling a wee bit weak and watery here. Well, just do it. Just get up and get on with it and don't complain. Maybe that's what it means. I'm not sure. Well, here's a question for you. Harris was reading for us just now about Jesus being tempted by the devil. And the devil was saying, just do it, Jesus. You're out here in the wilderness, and you're tired, you're hungry. Just do it. Just make some bread for yourself there. Or, do you know what? You've had enough of this hard training. Why not come with me and let me bring you somewhere comfortable where you'll have lots of wealth and pleasure? Or, do you know what? Maybe your father has set you too hard a mission here. Maybe your father is actually being a bit mean. You know, do you want to test that? Maybe if you jump off the wall of the temple there, will the angels catch you? Or maybe not. But Jesus, just you do it. Just you do whatever you want. What if Jesus had just done it? What if Jesus had just gone along with the temptations of the devil and said, yeah, okay. Ooh. Well, he wouldn't have been able to continue with his mission. The mission would have been failed. And we would still be in our sins. There'd be no salvation. The world would still be doomed. But Jesus didn't just do it. I'm thinking, if Jesus were to design a t-shirt for his followers, and he wanted to put an important message on it for us to do with temptation, I wonder what he would put. What would Jesus put on a t-shirt? Just do it? Oh, no, don't think so. When we just do it, when we just go along, and we get in all sorts of trouble. What would Jesus put? He would maybe put, just don't. Just don't. If you feel that you're being tempted to do something wrong or foolish or dangerous, well, just don't. You don't have to do it. Nobody's forcing you to. You can say, no, that's all right. Or maybe Jesus would put on the t-shirt, just think about it. Isn't that the problem? So many people don't think. They just go along with what others are doing and end up in all sorts of a mess. But maybe if they would think, they would say, no, hold on a second, that's not a wise way of going. That's dangerous. That's perhaps going to cause trouble for other people. No, I'm not going to do that. What would Jesus write on a t-shirt? He might say, just check the Bible first. Isn't that what he did? Every time the devil tempted him with something, Jesus replied using the scripture. It says in God's word. And that's what I'm basing my life and my choices on. So whenever next time you see an ad for Nike, or maybe if you've got some Nike if you've got a Nike sweatshirt that says that on it, you see yourself in the mirror, just say, well, I'm not going to just do everything. I'm going to say no to some things that I know are wrong. I'm going to, at the very least, think about it. And I'm going to check the Bible to see what would Jesus want me to do. And that's how I make my decisions. These are interesting times in which we're living, certainly. Some say they're like the days of Elijah or the days of Ezekiel long ago. And that's our next song. recognizing that we're living in challenging times, but also times of great opportunity when Christians can be filled with His Spirit and used by God to declare His truth and to bring light and hope to many people. So if you'd like to stand again, and we'll sing, "These Are the Days of Elijah." That's where she is now, just from this last week, and she is making a little progress, and we're very grateful for that and for all the help that she's received, the care she has received over the summer. Now, she's making some progress. We're glad for that. We're also glad that I'm allowed to visit Musgrave Park, because previously, for about 6 weeks, she was in a Southern Trust hospital and they didn't allow any visiting whatsoever. So we were doing video calls like this, you know, that was what we... Or I would go and stand in the car park like poor Romeo, looking up at the second floor window and kind of trying to wave from a distance. But I'm allowed to visit now. So would you like to see a picture? Okay, thanks, lovely. Cheers. Let's have a wee pic. This is... Thursday past was our wedding anniversary, so there you go, that's us. So we really appreciate all your thoughts, your kindness, your prayers, and please don't stop. She is making some progress, but there's still a long way to go, so please let's keep praying. So in our prayers, in just a moment, we're going to pray. We're going to pray for ourselves. We all need God's help. We're going to pray for our loved ones and our families. Of course we are. We're also asked to remember some other folk. On the PCI website, there are prayer requests every week, and we put those on our Cairncastle website. We update it every week now. So if you check on there, you'll see some fresh things to pray about each week. This is Peter and Valerie Lockwood, and they are global mission workers for PCI in Nepal. Now, we think we're getting it tough here with COVID. We just wish it was over. Of course we do. Well, imagine if you had a pandemic with much less of a health service, plus monsoon, rain, flooding, that's actually seriously hindering your communications and travel. So we're asked to pray for Peter and Valerie and for the church there in that part of Nepal, who are trying not just to survive themselves, but to reach out in Jesus' name and to bring some relief, literally to bring food aid to some of their neighbours who are in really quite dire straits at the moment. We're also going to pray for this gentleman, Colin McGaugh, Reverend McGaugh, who is a chaplain in Woodlands Juvenile Detention Centre here in Northern Ireland. And that's part of his ministry, is to go in and minister to young people who have, well, really, who are on the edge of criminal activity and in danger of becoming into a life of crime. And so Colin is trying to minister to those young people and hopefully, with God's help, influence them in a better way of going. So we're asked to pray for these people today. Shall we do so? Let's pray. Oh God, our Father, Abba, Father, Daddy, we come to you and we thank you for our families, for our dear ones. We thank you for the people in our church family here and across the world. Thank you that a number of different fellowships are represented here in the building right now. And we thank you that we can be united. We can be one in Christ, one in the Spirit. Thank you for belonging, for the gift of being loved by you and belonging in your family, that we can love one another and help and support one another. Thank you, dear Lord, for the care and concern shared, particularly in times of need, in times of distress and challenge, that our Christian brothers and sisters will pray for us and show kindness. Dear Lord, we pray for our dear ones, for those who are doing great, for those who are absolutely in the prime of life and loving life, but also for those who are facing challenge and difficulty, for those who are sad and brokenhearted, for those who are in tremendous distress. Oh dear Lord, will you please help us? Will you comfort us? Will you give us strength from beyond ourselves, courage, faith, to keep going, to be faithful, to be creative and to find new ways of showing love and goodness and kindness. Dear Lord, help us and those we love. And may your grace, your covenant grace, be upon our families. Because some of our people don't know you or are not following you. And we pray, dear Lord, that in your mercy, you would draw them. Good Shepherd, will you seek and save those who are lost and bring them to you. Lord, we remember Peter and Valerie and the church in that part of Nepal and the tremendous physical challenges they're facing just at the moment. Thank you that it is still in their hearts to show the love of Christ to their neighbours. Will you please help them to do so safely and well? And even in the most challenging of circumstances, will you continue to build your church in that land? We remember Reverend McGaugh also, who is once more allowed into Woodlands Juvenile Detention Centre, that the restrictions have eased there to allow him to continue his ministry. Oh Lord, will you fill him with your Spirit afresh and wisdom? Give him words to say and actions to show the love of Jesus and the inspirational light and the way of righteousness that is good to those young people. And dear Lord, will you save them from a bad and destructive way of going that will only hurt them and others? And will you bring them, dear Lord, to a path of light, the way of your kingdom, the way that is good, and help them to walk in it. Lord, hear these and all our prayers. We bring these to you now in the lovely name of Jesus. Amen. Let's sing again, shall we? We're going to honour the name of Jesus. We're going to sing, "You're the Word of God the Father from before the world began." Would you like to stand again, please? Let's listen to a little bit more of God's Word, reading from 1 Peter chapter 5, and I'm reading from verse 8. We've been looking at this first century letter over the summer, and we're almost at the end of it. Just another week next week, and that will just about finish us for now. But 1 Peter 5, reading from verse 8, this is the Word of God. "Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. May God bless his word to us here in Cairncastle today. Well, the Apostle Peter has written to encourage his fellow Christians in the face of cruel opposition. Peter himself would be martyred in Rome in the 60s AD, in the 1st century AD. But already, about 10 years before that, many of his Christian friends had suffered brutally for their faith in Christ. And so one of the themes of his letter is to encourage them in the face of all their challenges and the opposition to remain true to Jesus. Despite whatever painful trials we may face, the New Testament apostles urge us to stay faithful to our Savior, reassured by this promise that one day we are going to share Jesus' resurrection. Now, the real enemy, according to today's reading, are not the human beings who might be mean to us in work or in school, not those who are persecuting Christians in some countries of the world. The real enemy, the devil, the cruel spiritual source of all wickedness. And he's described here as being like a fierce lion hunting for his next victim. Now, some have romantic notions about angels and demons. If you look on Netflix, you'll see no shortage of fictional dramas featuring demons and angels. Other people are skeptical. They say, we don't really believe in that sort of thing at all. Well, Jesus and his apostles take these things very seriously indeed. And so, as on every other subject, we should note carefully what God says in his word, the Bible. And when we study the Bible, we find that Adam and Eve were not the original sinners. Theirs wasn't the first fall from grace. Last week, we were thinking here in Cairncastle about how pride comes before a... Thank you. Pride comes before a fall. And in Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel 28, we read of a beautiful angelic being, a cherub, a guardian angel, who ambitiously set out to take God's place. Pride was found in him, and he wanted to have the authority of God himself. And so he was punished. He was driven out of heaven. Vengeful, full of spite, this devil tries to strike back at God by hurting those God loves. He's a sore loser, and he's destined for eternal damnation, but he's trying to take as many of us as he can with him. And we see something of his tactics in the temptation of our Lord Jesus. The first appeal we see is to our physical appetites. Now observe the cruel way the enemy tries to exploit our weakness. We should have no sympathy for the devil. He is horrible. We should have given no time at all. Notice how he tries to exploit the weakness of Christ. He presses where it hurts. He kicks us when we're down. Jesus is in the wilderness at this point. He's training to begin his ministry, and he's hungry. So what does the devil do? He tries to distract him with thoughts of food. Wouldn't it be lovely if you could just make those stones into bread? You're the son of God, you can do it, can't you? And with many people, the devil may never need to go beyond our natural desires for food and drink and comfort and things that bring us physical gratification and pleasure. It may not have to be anything more sophisticated than a little bit of sex or alcohol, and we fall all too readily. Now, another appeal is to worldly wealth and prestige. Again, reading the Bible carefully, it is not a sin to have some money or to have some possessions. And indeed, on occasions, God blessed people with material wealth. That was one way in which he blessed people. We should be thankful for what we have as a blessing from our generous Father in heaven. The problem comes is when we begin to focus on the things rather than on the relationship. We begin to love the gifts more than the good Father in heaven who gives them to us. We can put popularity, we can put social standing, we can put our love of control and power above other things like righteousness or obedience. The devil comes to Jesus and shows him all the prestige and the wealth of the world and says, come my way, and you can enjoy all of this. It's an easy trap to fall into, but again, disastrous spiritually. A third common temptation is to doubt God's goodness or his power to save us. The devil takes Jesus to a high point in the temple, and he says, go on, jump off. It says the angels will catch you. Do you want to test that? Does God your Father really care? Let's try it out, shall we? What if your prayer is not answered? And so he tries to get us to doubt God's goodness or God's power. Can we still trust God when we're facing difficult circumstances? And many Christians, it's true, tragically backslide into sin or indeed just cynical despair when they're facing hard times, and they succumb to the lying voice that whispers God is unfair. God will not or cannot help us. Now, the encouraging thing in the reading we had earlier from the Gospel of Luke is our Master didn't fall for any of these schemes. Jesus stood firm on the truths and the promises of Scripture. And so let's understand, it is not inevitable for us to sin. We don't have to. No one's forcing us. Yes, we must expect some temptation and it will be very difficult, but we don't have to fall for it. The Apostle James writes that we should submit to God and resist the devil and he will flee from you. Be aware of the enemy, writes Peter, but resist him. Stand firm in your faith. Don't be afraid to stand up to him. And we can when we remember that we, Christians, are on the winning side. Remember, your brothers and sisters throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings, Peter says. We're not alone. We're part of a worldwide fellowship, a family, the family of God, united through Christ, indwelt by the Holy Spirit. We're in this together. Now, we've seen over the last 18 months, there's been some tremendous acts of public-minded service. Some people have really behaved in an exemplary way during this pandemic. People thinking, not just of themselves, but thinking about their neighbours. Again, over the years in ministry, I have frequently witnessed at times of particular challenge and difficulty, even heartache. That is when church members go the extra mile, show that extra loyalty, that thoughtfulness, generosity, kindness. It's whenever we are struggling, when we feel weak, that we realize not just the strength and the grace of God, but also the fellowship, the kindness of our fellow believers. So, despite whatever wickedness the enemy tries to stir up, let God's people never tire in trusting him and doing good supporting one another as believers together, looking for ways to demonstrate his grace to everyone. Remembering this, that integrity is vital to our witness. Yes, we can be kind, but lots of people are kind. Lots of people are generous, not just Christians. The Apostle Paul writes encouraging words in 1 Corinthians 10, but he puts along with that encouragement a word of challenge and caution. He says Christians are to exercise self-discipline. We are to live a holy life, a righteous life, a life of integrity. He says, if you think you're standing firm, be careful, you don't fall. We don't have to fall, but anyone could, anyone might. He goes on to say this, no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. We're not alone, we're in this together. God is faithful, he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. And look at the encouraging reassurance Peter gives here in chapter 5 and verse 10. Our comfort is not just in knowing the fellowship and support of other Christians. Our confidence is in the Lord himself. The God of all grace, writes Peter, the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ after you've suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. So let's understand that while the devil is the source of temptation and wickedness and sorrow, God, our God, is the source of all grace. We need help. He is more than willing to give it. We don't deserve it, but he is still eager to help. We are all out of hope. The world seems to be getting increasingly hopeless. But Christ bore our sins and griefs on the cross to promise us nothing less than heaven and resurrection like his own. We quickly get lost in our own stupid disobedience. But he has provided the forgiveness, the new beginning, the guidance that we need. According to Peter here, this gracious God will limit our trials. He will supply the strength we need. And in time, he will welcome us to share heavenly glory with our Savior. Yes, from our present perspective, our sufferings may seem unending. We think, when is this ever going to be over? When are we ever going to see better days again? But from the perspective of our home in glory, when we look back, it will seem to have been only a little while. And we will give thanks to God, who in his mercy heard our prayers and our need and made it so. He limits our suffering. He restores our souls and he gives us the courage and the strength that we are so often lacking. Jesus promised he would not leave us alone. He sends the Spirit to be among us and within us, to equip us for his service and every challenge that that will bring. As we sometimes sing, yes, I am weak, but the one who is in me is strong. Now we will know God's goodness and help in this life and beyond. Our destiny is nothing less than glory with Christ. He has risen victorious over death. When he returns, so shall we. This is our calling, Christians. We shall not be satisfied until we join in the company of his redeemed before his throne to praise and serve him evermore. Meanwhile, let us not be found endlessly enamored with lesser things. Let Christ be our life and our goal, and to God be the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for your servant Peter, who, inspired by your Spirit, wrote these words in the first century, while he and his friends were facing tremendous hardship. Nevertheless, he celebrated the hope that we have been given as Christians through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. May that be our hope here in Cairncastle and the fellowships represented here today and our friends who are joining us online. May that be our hope. Whatever our circumstances just now, may we be filled with the hope of the resurrection. And as we live in anticipation of that, may we know your joy and your strength and your peace today and throughout all the days of our life here upon earth. Dear Lord, don't just encourage us. Take us and use us today for your glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to declare our faith again, express our faith, our trust, almost in defiance of some of our present circumstances. We're going to trust that our Father will look after us and supply all our need, and we're going to be glad about that. So when I invite you to stand again, we're going to sing our closing praise, which is, "Rejoice, rejoice, Christ is in you, the hope of glory in our hearts." say the grace. We're saying this for ourselves. We all need the grace of God. But we're also saying for the people beside us, mm-hmm. for the people who we love, who are far away, wherever they may be, we're praying God's grace. Let's say it now. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Please take your seats.